Well, it's time to bring it on with some of your email questions. Pat, this first one is from Margie, who says, Pat, do you believe that there would ever be a one-world religion? What are your thoughts about this?
I think if you look at the book of Revelation, there's a antichrist figure, the world dictator, but there's also what's called a false prophet, and he's the one that regulates the buying and selling. And I think the time will come, some sort of a syncretistic one-world government and possibly one-world religion. So it is certainly possible. I don't know for certain, but I think it's mentioned in Scripture.
Okay, this is Marie, who says, my elderly mother-in-law lives with me, my husband, and our two small children because she can't live by herself anymore. At first, we got along great, but I think it's because she didn't live with us then. Now it's like her true colors are coming out. She openly disrespects me in front of my children and my husband. She makes fun of my faith, and I've just recently become a born-again Christian. She argues with me about the choices I make for my children. She favors one grandchild over the other. I've prayed for God to open my heart and eyes and see her the way He does, but honestly, she's driving me nuts. I have no idea what to do anymore. What does the Bible say about this?
Well, the Bible says we're supposed to look after the mothers and fathers, and that's part of our obligation. You ought to talk to your husband about it because it's his mother. She's not your mother. And he ought to see what she's doing. I don't think it's necessary to take elderly people into your home if there's another provision. Right now, we've got marvelous nursing homes. We've got excellent care. We have senior living facilities that are very spacious, and the food is delicious, and the fellowship is good, and they have activities. And I think people can sit around and they can feel miserable about their lives, and the longer they do it, the more miserable they feel, that they reflect that on other people. So why don't you talk to your husband about the possibility of finding some really comfortable place for your mother-in-law to live, where she'll be with elderly people and enjoy herself?
Mm-hmm. This is Diane, who says, I married over a decade ago to a man I believed to be saved. After I got married to him, he began to look at porn, lie, cheat, and so many other things. He's abandoned our children and me many times. No one has held him accountable. He also refuses to accept accountability for a lot he has done. I have researched his behavior, and at best, he greatly resembles a narcissist. Almost everything I've researched and people who've encountered narcissists say there's no hope and to stay away. Now that I know what he may be and we are separated due to his leaving again, I almost believe this. Is narcissism demonic? How should we as Christians view and deal with this type of person, especially since I have children by him? Wow, that was a long...
I tell you, ladies, you make these decisions to get in relationship with these losers, and then you wonder why you're having trouble. But all right, in ancient mythology, Narcissus was the guy who looked at himself in the water, and he was so handsome he fell in love with his own image. So narcissism is really being in love with yourself. I don't think it's demonic. I just think it's the way it is. And there are many people who...
A condition, would you call it, or a state of mind?
Well, it's a psychological condition where you love yourself. I mean, that's what it amounts to, and everything revolves around you. Now, look, the guy's apparently cheated on you. He's left you. He hadn't taken care of you. Why don't you let it all go and stop researching his psychological problem and get a divorce? He is separated from him right now. Go ahead and get the paperwork and get it done and get a court order that indicates he's got to look after your minor children. I don't know how old they are. Once they get older, they leave. But while they're still young, he owes...
You're saying financially, look after them.
You look after financially, that's right. But don't be going through psychological books trying to... You're not a psychiatrist, so why bother? By the way, if you really want to get a degree in that, we give it at Regent University. We graduate people with doctorates of psychology, and they'll learn about these maladies, and they can maybe help you.
Yeah, also right. Not bash your husband to the kids, probably, would be
well,
a
I
good...
mean, just get out of it and forget it. Let it go. You know, the idea of you're researching his psychological condition, that's nonsense.
Okay, this is Rose, who says, hi, Pat. I was wondering if it's wrong to ask God for death.
Well, you remember, what was it, Elijah said, take my life, it's, you know, I'm not worthy to live. There are many people of God who figured they've come to the end of their life, they want to die. Is it wrong to do it? I mean, you're going to ask God and He's not going to give you anything that's not in accordance with His will. I think the best thing to do is to live and to glorify the Lord. But some people, the pain is so strong, it's suffering. I don't think any of us can conceive of what it'd be like to be a prisoner in a concentration camp, to be beaten and tortured year after year. I was reading about a Chinese dissident who was burned with cigarettes, and they stuck toothpicks in his genitals, and it just went on and on. The torture he went through, starved. He was given like one crust of bread a day to eat. I mean, it was just horrible. And of course, somebody like that would cry out to God for death, but the Lord is in control of it. And, you know, people overcome, and so you need to ask God to give you strength to bear. There's no temptation, no testing that's taken you, but such as is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted, tested above your ability. But with the temptation, we'll make a way of escape that you can bear it. All right, one last thing.
Okay, this is Chris who says, Pat, what do you think? Do you think the Muslim people would come back to the truth of Christianity? Because I read the booklet, Islam, Religion of Peace or War, and I found that Muhammad spoke lies, I'm still wondering how we as Christians can show the truth about Christ. What are we supposed to do?
Well, I think what you're supposed to do is to show the truth about Islam. And we do that at CBN with mm-hmm. some programs that we do. We are probably the largest producer of Christian-themed Arabic language programs in the world. And the Muslim people are coming alive to the truth of God. But you say, come back to the Christianity. They never were with Christianity, so there's nothing to come back to. They have to be shown, you're children of Abraham. You're part of the covenant of God. God loves you. And Jesus Christ loves you, and He died for you. And it's the same message to Muslims as it is to anybody. It is the love of God. Well, if you want, you were mentioning, you were reading this mm-hmm. book. This is a wonderfully produced book. It was written by people who were experts in the Islamic faith, Arabic speakers, and it was researched, and it's very accurate. And it has some amazing truth about where Muhammad came from and what he believed and where all that stuff comes from. So we'll give you that to you for free if you want it. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you for those questions. Mm-hmm.